Channel 13, where the news comes first.
The storm has landed on the East Coast. Forecasters are already saying the amount of snow dumping right now could reach historic amounts. We'll bring you a live report.
And while we're not tracking that much snow, we are tracking the storm system, which is going to make its way through the area. We'll have the details and show you that forecast.
And a busy night for Colorado Springs Fire Department's two blazes kept crews busy for hours. We'll tell you the next step in their investigations. Thanks for joining us this morning. It's 8 a.m. on your Saturday, January 23rd. I'm Bonnie Silkman. Well, first up this morning, a blizzard is barreling down on the East Coast. More than 2 feet of snow is expected in our nation's capital. We've seen thousands of crashes. This massive storm has already turned deadly. Right now, we're turning over to ABC's Kenneth Moten. He is live from Washington, D.C.
Well, the snowfall has been steady here in our nation's capital. Let me give you an idea of what we're dealing with here. Take a look at this. Walk with me here, and you can see that we have a lot of snow piled up here. We've got more than a foot of snow already fallen in D.C., and we are expecting for 1 to 2 inches per hour.
Blizzard blast. Blinding whiteout conditions, heavy snow, and bone-chilling winds. This morning, there are blizzard watches and warnings from D.C. to New York. Airports in the Northeast closed. Thousands of flights canceled.
Can't wait to get out of town.
In Philadelphia, the streets are covered. A snow emergency is in effect. In D.C., it's predicted to be the biggest blizzard since the 1920s. More than 2 feet of snow expected.
It has life and death implications.
This massive winter storm impacting more than 80 million people left a blanket of snow in the south. It's also wreaked havoc. In Kentucky, a 35-mile stretch of I-75 closed, leaving more than 3,000 drivers stranded in the cold. Emergency shelters are open. In the Carolinas, Georgia, and Virginia, snowplows are working overtime. There have been thousands of crashes on the roadways. Several people have died.
Yes, it's definitely ice underneath. I've slid several times this morning in my dump truck.
Emergency crews have also been working around the clock to save even our four-legged friends.
Come on, Milo.
In Fairfax Station, Virginia, this large St. Bernard named Milo fell through the ice in this freezing lake. Firefighters jumped into action, rescued the dog, and got him warmed up.
Serious stuff, but you can't help but to marvel at scenes like this here in Washington, D.C. I can tell you people have been told to hunker down as they ride out this storm, but many of them are doing it in the dark. Hundreds of thousands of people are without electricity, but crews are working to restore power. Reporting live here in Washington, Kenneth Moten, ABC News, back to you.
Wow, Kenneth, thanks so much. Well, meanwhile, here in Colorado, travelers are already feeling the effects of that storm. There are already several delays and cancellations at DIA. We're taking a live look right now at the flight status. This is at the Colorado Springs Airport at the website right now. Things really not looking too bad as we scroll down and look at all flights. Looks like everything is on schedule, but as we mentioned, not the same story for Denver International Airport. Plenty of flights there have been delayed. A few have been canceled. Remember, if you're traveling, be sure to check your flight status at KRDO.com. Just look under the hot button. Well, for those of us staying put in Colorado, lucky for you, it's going to be a beautiful day. Some areas could even reach the 60s today. And it will be a great day to head to the high country, just like this Broncos fan did yesterday. This is at the Loveland Ski Resort. That is just gorgeous. I guess he skied up with that flag. Well prepared, all decked out in orange, United in orange, of course. Yeah, it's kind of a big game tomorrow. No big deal. All right, let's take a live look outside in Salida right now, looking at Mount Chavanoux. Just a gorgeous start to our Saturday morning. Blue skies and snow up on the peaks there. Just amazing to see that. Now we're going to kick things over to Storm Tracker 13's meteorologist Jay Polk. He is live in the Weather Center. Now, Jay, we've been talking about how gorgeous it is today, but everyone wants to know about tomorrow, the big game in the Mile High. Things are going to be changing, unfortunately.
That's right. We could see some rain at the game. That's very unusual for late January in Denver, but it is a possibility as we go through the second half of for the weekend for us as well. That's one of the things that we're tracking for you as we go through this morning. A nice day today. Temperatures about 15 or 20 degrees above where they should be by the time we finish it off. Clouds will return those as we go through this afternoon into this evening. They'll begin to assemble and thicken as we go through the day today. And you can see in the live HD Doppler radar right now, there are very few showers around. In fact, no showers nowhere. As we look at the full live HD Doppler radar range, all the way from Grand Junction over towards the Kansas line, down to the New Mexico line too. Same thing as you go into Oklahoma. Not much to talk about, at least not right now. Right now, temperatures are on the warm side, 40 in the Springs. That's pretty close to the average high to this point in the year, 43 in Canyon City, 13 below in Gunnison and 2 below in Alamosa, but 22 in Leadville. So temperatures are showing quite a bit of variation as you go up into the high country, and they're also showing variation between the Springs and Pueblo, 40 in the Springs, 27 in Pueblo, lower to middle 20s out in the plains. Day forecast for today calls for high temperatures to top out in the lower 60s in the Springs and in Pueblo, just touching 60. It's all about the cloud cover. The more clouds we see, the cooler the temperatures are going to be, but I think we'll still top out at 60 degrees in the Springs. That would, again, be about 15 or so degrees above a normal. Already close to it, as we talked about a second ago. By noon, we're already sitting in the mid to upper 50s. Details in that 7-day forecast show you what the skycast is calling for in terms of the snow coming up in just a couple of minutes. Bonnie?
All right, Jay, thank you. Crews are trying to figure out what happened to what started a grass fire last night that burned a small patch of land in Colorado Springs. This happened off 30th Street and Colorado Avenue around 11:30. Now, it broke out right next to a car wash. Luckily, that business was not damaged. No one was hurt. The fire department got the flames out quickly, and a patch of grass next to Fountain Creek was the only thing visibly affected. The cause of this fire is still under investigation. Also new this morning, firefighters are piecing together how a fire began at an apartment complex in Colorado Springs. This happened at the Shannon Glen Apartments, and that's where we can find KRDO News Channel 13's Katie Spencer. She has been following the story all morning. Katie, what can you tell us?
That's right, Bonnie. The Colorado Springs Fire Department was called out really early this morning around 1:30 to reports of a fire here at the Shannon Glen Apartments. Now, this fire started in a hallway and it damaged a few appliances. As of now, they think the appliance was left out in the hallway that was caught on fire and spread to a pile of trash that was also left out. They're still investigating exactly what happened. No injuries were reported and no one was displaced. We will, of course, keep you updated on this situation as we learn more. Reporting live in Colorado Springs, I'm Katie Spencer, KRDO News Channel 13.
Katie, thank you so much. And a scary moment for one pilot after a small plane crashed near Steamboat Springs Airport. This happened yesterday afternoon, according to the Steamboat pilot. Steamboat Today newspaper provided this photo for us where you can see the plane and all the snow there. Now, the small plane lost power after taking off. It crashed into a snowfield north of the airport. The woman who was flying the plane is okay. She walked away without injuries. The airport manager says this plane is based out of the Steamboat Airport. A man dressed up as Santa, who is accused of stabbing a passenger on a bus, has been identified. Police say Brian DeLome was arrested this week in Walsenburg regarding a different case. However, officers believe he is the Santa stabber. Police said DeLome left his cell phone at the scene. It took them a while to find him because he is apparently homeless, and the stabbing victim did survive. Sad news in Rocky Mountain National Park. Searchers say they have found the body of a hiker who was reported missing on Thursday. 58-year-old Ronald Weber of Maitland, Florida, rather, but he was found dead at the bottom of a cliff on Friday. Parks and Wildlife says he may have fallen about 200 feet. Weber reported starting his hike from the Long's Peak trailhead outside of Estes Park on Tuesday morning, but he never returned. The Air Force says maintenance errors by three airmen caused bad damage to a nuclear-armed missile that was sitting in its launch pad in Colorado. It's a mistake that cost them their nuclear certification and triggered an accident investigation. Now, the Air Force says this happened in May of 2014, but they're only explaining the consequences. They have refused to provide any details of the accident, saying this is classified and too sensitive to make public. Time now, 8:09 on your Saturday morning. Well, two teens were found dead in their California home yesterday. Now police are fearing that the suspect may have left the country. Authorities are now looking into this case. We'll have the latest from their early investigation. And sad news from Wisconsin after a five-year-old boy was shot while simply riding in a car. We'll tell you what led up to this tragedy.
As we look at the Skyscan satellite and radar around the East Coast, you can see that storm is pounding Port Kenneth Moton there in Washington, D.C. Moving off to the west, you can also see another storm system coming on shore here in Colorado, but southern Colorado at this hour, not too much to talk about. A few clouds mixed in with some sunshine. Airport delays, less than 15 minutes at the Springs Airport. Buddy's nearby to talk about there are some possible delays in Denver today. And, of course, Atlanta, not surprising given that it's snow. It's delays increasing and more than an hour at this point at Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport. Have the details on that forecast coming up.
Same headline under top news on our website. We just got an email from a viewer that's like, what's up with the two links, same headline under top news on your website? Two links, same headline? Maybe we have a story up twice? I don't know. Welcome back, everyone. A beautiful view right now. This is in Wolf Creek Pass, US 160, looking west. This is with our neighborhood weather network cameras. Just a gorgeous view. Sun is out. You can see the snow. The road does look clear, so that's good news for drivers out there. 24 degrees. We are in for a very beautiful and warm day here in southern Colorado on this Saturday. Things are going to change later in the weekend for us, but we can stay with today, stay with the good news for now. And our time is now 8:12. Two teenagers were killed in Arcadia, California yesterday. Now sheriff's deputies say their uncle, who is wanted in connection to their murder, has boarded a plane to China. A 15 and 16-year-old boy, they were both found dead on separate levels of the home yesterday afternoon. Police say the teens both suffered blunt force trauma. And according to authorities, there were signs of forced entry to the home. The teens were staying at their aunt and uncle's house. The parents of the teenagers had visited them the night before they were found dead.
They went to bed, they woke up this morning, and that's when they discovered the two victims.
Police say their uncle boarded a plane to Beijing yesterday morning. Deputies say the FBI is working to detain him at customs. Police in Wisconsin are asking the public for help as they investigate the killing of a five-year-old boy. This happened late last night. Police say the boy was shot while he was riding in a car with his father. They say someone fired several shots at the car from another vehicle, then drove away. This is being investigated as a drive-by. Officers say the shooting happened on a busy road. They believe someone may have seen what happened. The historic East Coast blizzard of 2016 has hundreds of motorists in Kentucky stranded. Just ahead, we'll tell you what police are telling those to do who are caught in the storm's path.
Well, we certainly have seen some very difficult conditions on the roads, at least in some parts of the nation. That's the case in Kentucky, but not here. Saturday drive looking pretty good along Interstate 70, I-25, and also along Highway 50 between La Junta and the Kansas line. We'll take you all around the west and show you that next storm system that will give us some snow Sunday and Monday. We'll show you the details in that forecast in just a few minutes. good looking start to our weekend around southern Colorado. Kind of chilly in some places, like in the eastern plains, where temperatures are sitting in the lower 20s. 22 in Los Animas at Highway 50 and Highway 101 as we look from the Bent County Courthouse Neighborhood Weather Network camera. Winds out of the northwest at 5 miles per hour. We'll top out in the lower 60s, though, in the plains, so dry air will allow for some pretty big spreads between lows this morning and highs this afternoon. 63 your high today in La Junta, 62 at Lamar, 65 in Springfield, and also Trinidad. 64 is where we'll top out at in Pueblo, 60 in the spring, 62 in Canyon City. 20s, 30s, and 40s up in the mountains, 48 for Salida, but 23 your high today in Gunnison. As we zoom out now to the western view to give you an idea of what things look like, temperatures, you'll notice, are fairly mild, much milder than they were at this time last weekend. 38 in Rapid City, 40 in the Springs, 30 in Casper, 25 at Helena, 43 in Seattle, 40 in Reno, 21 in Kansas City, 19 in Minneapolis, 28 in Chicago. At this point, as we notice, the SkyScan satellite and radar showing us this next storm system is coming on shore. So at this point, we are beginning to track some showers that are making their way through portions of Nevada and also into Idaho, California, Oregon. Good news, of course, because they've been in such a significant drought over the better part of the past half decade. But bottom line is that the storm system is coming in our direction and will be here as we go through our Sunday morning, Sunday afternoon especially. By 6 o'clock this evening, we begin to pick up a few extra clouds. That's indicated by these grayish colors here on your screen. That's true also as we go through our early Sunday morning. As we go through our Sunday afternoon, this is when we begin to pick up that chance for some snow, starting over towards the Continental Divide and pushing eastward as we go through our Sunday afternoon. Here's the view by 3 o'clock. You notice that snow, I-25 westward over towards the mountains. And that snow begins to spread its way into the eastern plains by early Monday morning, and then eventually into western portions of Kansas by 6 o'clock, as just about everything will be gone by that point. As we look at our skycast, we notice that the low pressure center will be well off to our east as well. Cold air, of course, filters in behind it, gives us a chance for some snow as we go on the backside of that low into portions of Nebraska and Kansas by Monday morning. How much snow are we talking about? Well, the skycast, we push it out to early Monday morning to give you an idea of what it's talking about in terms of snow predictions. In the areas off to our west, you notice that the skycast, the latest model run, is nowhere near as snowy as it was before, but still, decent amounts of snow are possible up Highway 24 towards Woodland Park. Southwest of Pueblo will also pick up a decent amount of snow. Wetmore, our friend Bob out there in the west, will pick up some good amounts, and that'll be the case as we go west of Leadville into the high country as well. To the southeastern plains we go here. Kim, now predicted to pick up about 2.5 inches by this point. That's a little bit higher with this latest skycast one than we saw earlier on. 7-8 forecast then for the Springs. High temperatures go from 60 to 37 between Saturday and Monday. That's a 23 degree difference. Doing some quick math there. Temperatures then topping out in the lower to middle 50s at the end of the outlook. Pueblo will go from 64 to 42 between Saturday and Monday with a stop in the 50s on Sunday. Temperatures then top out in the upper 50s and lower 60s towards next weekend. Canyon City, you'll be in the lower 60s today, then lower 40s on Monday, lower 50s on Sunday. Then temperatures top out in the mid to upper 50s as we go through our Thursday and Friday. And in Teller County, 51 our high today, 40 tomorrow. Then it's 28, the best we'll be able to do on Monday. Temperatures then rebound, lower to middle 40s by Thursday and Friday. Lows are sitting in the upper teens and lower 20s on the low end of the scale.
All right, a little bit of everything. Jay, thanks so much for the heads up. Appreciate it. Hundreds of drivers are completely stranded on a remote and icy stretch of highway in Kentucky. Traffic is backed up for at least 35 miles. Kentucky State Patrol says there were so many crashes on I-75 in Rockcastle County, they had to shut it down. No one was seriously hurt, fortunately. However, drivers who are out there right now cannot move in any direction. Officials have set up at least 2 shelters for stranded travelers. But police say there are no vacancies at nearby hotels. Still no word yet on when this highway will reopen. Time now, 8:21. We're just 24 hours away from knowing who is going to the 50th Super Bowl in California. Fans here in Colorado are gearing up themselves for the big game. We'll show you just how big Bronco fever is getting here in the Springs.
Coming up in sports, a lot of shootouts last night in hockey, including the exhilarating game in Grand Forks between the Tigers and the Fighting Hawks. Sports in just a bit.
This line's been good tonight. Watch this wide open.
Now, Rob Namnoon with Southern Colorado's award-winning sports.
Good morning, everybody. Well, the Air Force hockey team shut out Niagara last night at home by a score of 3-0. And after the first period of last night's Tigers game, they could have easily shriveled up and gone into the fetal position. But that was not the case in North Dakota last night for the Tigers. Tigers taking on the number two team in the country. They were down 4-0 when Christian Heil steals the puck and he skates in and wins this battle. A shorthanded goal. What a night for Hunter Fegis. The old turn and shoot rings the crossbar. Tigers cut the lead to 4-3. Then in the third, Fegis bringing the puck in. Great feed to Trey Bradley. He taps it in. Game tied at 4. And then some gorgeous passing here. Fegis, just a beast last night. He's going to score from a tough angle. Tigers scored 5 unanswered goals. Tyler Marble made some tough saves, including in the 2 OTs. This one that went over the cage. North Dakota would score the only goal in the shootout, so they pick up 2 points. Tigers pick up a point. It counts as a tie. It ends 5-5 after a shootout. DU, they took on Duluth last night, pick it up in the second period when the Pies are buzzing the net. Dayton Heinen scores from the impossible angle, and the Pioneers would win by a score of 3-2. More NCHC action. Miami of Ohio taking on Nebraska, mixing it up last night. Tied at 1 late in the game when Matthew Cato, some mustard on that shot. Miami of Ohio wins 3-1. Semyon Varlamov and the Avs hosting the Blues last night. This game would be decided in a shootout. Varley makes the glove save, shows it to everybody. Avs win 2-1 in the shootout. Now, after last Sunday's Pittsburgh Steelers playoff game, Chris Harris couldn't even lift his left shoulder. Harris says he's doing much better this week. He plans on playing in the AFC Championship game against the Patriots. He's been dealing with that left shoulder injury since the final game of the regular season. 2 years ago, Harris missed the AFC Championship due to injury.
This game means so much to me just because I didn't get to play in the game last time. So not being able to play in this AFC Championship, it means the most to me since I missed it last time.
I'm looking forward to take advantage of it. Make sure I say my prayers. Hopefully I can stay healthy throughout this one. This will be a big game for us.
Now, all the smack talk leading up to the AFC Championship game is over. You recall earlier in the week when Broncos linebacker said that Rob Gronkowski catches a lot of passes because Gronk does a lot of pushing off. Now, after making those claims about number 87, Marshall received a ton of messages from Patriots fans on Twitter.
I definitely wasn't aware that all the Patriots fans would be in my Twitter mentions and calling me, you know, all kind of explicit names, and I'm sorry, I'm, you know, whatever. I don't want to say the names, but I didn't think that would happen. But
let's look at sports, everybody. I'm Rob Namnoom. Have a good day.
Rob, thanks. Time now 8:27 on your Saturday. Here's what's coming up next on Good Morning Colorado. The historic blizzard of 2016 already affecting more than 75 million people across the East Coast. We'll have the latest on the storm's impact and how travelers are handling this severe weather. And we're finding out what charges are being brought to a woman who is accused of stabbing Denver's fire chief. That's ahead after the break.
And, of course, the Bronco game tomorrow is going to feature something unusual, not necessarily snow, but rain. And temperatures sitting in the upper 40s when they kick it off at 1:05 in the afternoon. Mostly cloudy skies, though. Temperatures are way normal than they would certainly be normally in Denver for a January playoff game. Details and that forecast are coming up.
Yeah, mic check. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Mic check. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Mic check. 1, 2, 3. Perfect. I'm all sorts of dangled.
Just wondering if she irised down a bit. Okay. And maybe take a step back. Okay. Perfect.
From Southern Colorado's high-definition news leader, this is News Channel 13, where the news comes first.
Welcome back to Good Morning Colorado, everyone. It is 8:30 right now on your Saturday morning. I'm Bonnie Silkman. Well, from fire to ice, harsh weather is hitting millions of people up and down the East Coast. Parts of the South are also getting a blast of this wicked weather. Several deaths are already being blamed on this weather, which could rank the worst in nearly a century. 30 million people are now under blizzard warnings as the storm moves north.
I want to be very clear with everybody. We see this as a major storm. It has life and death implications.
Washington, D.C. is one of the storm's biggest targets as of right now. Now, people up and down the East Coast are saying that they're buckled down and ready for the storm, and they've hit the stores, all the grocery stores, of course, before they all closed. Now, we're going to take a live look right now. This is from Times Square in New York City. You can just see the snow blowing all around. Yeah, more and more people have been going to Times Square, I'm sure, to get video and photos because it's just quite the sight there. You really can't see much on the streets. People were making snowballs earlier this morning. It's pretty crazy to see, but yes, scary conditions. You can see a little plow truck coming through right there trying to, you know, do what he can there in Times Square. All right, yeah, scary stuff on the East Coast right now. And travelers coming to and headed out of Colorado are already being impacted by that major storm on the East Coast. Dozens of flyers are seeing delays and cancellations for direct flights to the East Coast, even for connecting flights. Now, according to the website flightaware.com, more than 5,000 flights were delayed, 3,000 canceled nationwide. Today, those numbers could be higher. And some people, of course, are racing to leave the Northeast. And their reasoning is pretty simple.
To get away from the snow, because they said it was going to be from 6 to 12 inches, maybe up to 24 inches in spots.
Absolutely. And travelers in the spring seem to be taking the delays in stride. Well, turning to our weather right now, it's a really nice start to our day for those of us, you know, who aren't traveling and staying here in Southern Colorado. Taking a live look right now in Lamar, east of town, with our new exclusive Viero Wireless Neighborhood Weather Network cameras. A beautiful view out there. Got some blue skies. And Jay, we've been talking about it all morning. Some areas in Southern Colorado could see the 60s today. What is going on? That is crazy.
It is unusually warm, but it's the warm ahead of the storm. We're going to see another storm system make its way into our neck of the woods as well, Bonnie, later on this weekend. Lamar also picking up some patchy fog. You see a few clouds on the Viero Wireless Network camera. Visibility is down to 6 miles. That's not exactly cut down super bad. It's not exactly one of those deals where you have to really slow down, but you maybe slow down just a shade as you head on Highway 50 coming east of La Junta towards the Kansas line. As you look at the rest of the screen, you notice that it's top of the scale 10-mile stuff for the visibility. facilities around the rest of the region. Live HD Doppler radar, not much to talk about. Only a few false echoes west of I-25. It's about it. Right now, temperatures are showing quite a bit of variation. It is 20 in Lamar, 22 in La Junta, and 27 in Pueblo. But as you go north from Pueblo to the Springs in Canyon City, you see temperatures rise up into the 40s. To the west of Pueblo, along 50 over in Canyon City, it's 45. Walsenburg is 44. We have 13 below in Gunnison and 2 below in Alamosa, but 22 in Leadville, 34 in Denver. Day tracker then for today for the Springs. High temperatures are going to top out right around 60 degrees by 3 o'clock. We'll see increasing amounts of cloud cover as the day goes on, but not a huge amount of clouds. There will still be some sunshine out there. In Pueblo, we make our way up into the lower to middle 60s. 64 is our high today. That's our temperature at 3 o'clock. Then we drop it back into the upper 30s by 9 o'clock tonight with us. Mix of moon and clouds out there. Not bad night for stargazing, but again, there will be extra clouds to deal with compared to what we saw last night. Details in that forecast let you know what our skycast is thinking in terms of the snow totals coming up in just a couple of minutes.
All right, Jay, thank you so much. New this morning, an overnight fire that happened at the Shannon Glen Apartments in Colorado Springs is now being investigated. That's where we find KRDO News Channel 13's Katie Spencer. She is live at the apartment complex where the fire started very early this morning. Good morning, Katie.
That's right, Bonnie. The fire investigation is still ongoing. The fire started really this early this morning around 1:30 a.m. Firefighters said it started in the hallway of the complex. As of now, they think an appliance that was left out in the hallway caught on fire and spread to a pile of trash that was also left out. No injuries were reported and no one was displaced. We'll keep you updated on the situation as we learn more. Reporting live in Colorado Springs, Katie Spencer, KRDO News Channel 13.
Katie, thanks so much. A woman in Denver is being held on a $100,000 bond after she's accused of stabbing Denver's fire chief. Prosecutors have formally charged 42-year-old Marlene Zasvik Rodriguez with attempted second-degree murder and first-degree assault. Fire Chief Eric Tate was in an unmarked SUV on Tuesday when a woman jumped into the car and stabbed him in the hand and the leg. He was hospitalized, but he's doing just fine. He's already back at work. Rodriguez will be in court on Tuesday. And there are a few roadwork projects happening in Colorado Springs that could affect your morning commute on Monday. Workers are repairing cracks off of Palmer Park Boulevard to LaSalle Street and also off of Jet Wing Drive to Cul-de-Sac. Crews are also doing some work from Constitution Avenue to Oriole Avenue and at Boulder Street to Children's View. That roadwork will reduce traffic to one lane and it should end on Friday. A major heroin investigation in southern Colorado nets a new arrest. Woodland Park police say the primary heroin dealer was arrested, and he's just one of 10 others. Police first started this investigation in September when they noticed an uptick in heroin use. They've been investigating ever since. Now, the newest arrest happened yesterday. 20-year-old Ian Forbes from Divide was arrested in Woodland Park. He now faces a felony drug charge. There are four primary dealers involved in this, all from Woodland Park. Police believe the source is connected to a Mexican cartel. However, dealers involved are all throughout southern Colorado. Officers say the drug has been a growing problem.
From what I gather from the Metro VNI unit, it's a growing problem everywhere, nationwide, in fact. And there is an effort that many law enforcement agencies are working towards, which is trying to help the or stop the overdoses on heroin and opiates.
Police say more arrests are likely since there are 25 people now under investigation. New surveillance video released by Pueblo police shows the beating of a man after he left a bar. This happened just after 3 o'clock Friday morning in the 100 block of University Circle. That's in the Sunset Park area of Pueblo on the south side. Take a look here. The victim got a ride as he was leaving Legends Sports Bar around closing time. In this video released, you can actually see that he was dropped out of a white Honda next to a pickup. And that's when he was attacked. Police say there was also some kind of verbal fight in the process, but the victim was so badly beaten that when officers found him, he was unconscious. Police also say someone else in this area confronted the attacker, and that person got back in the truck and then drove off.
He did suffer some serious injuries, so when we can identify the person that's responsible for this and their involvement, it's going to help the case out and the investigation as well as justice for the victim.
Now, Pueblo Police is asking that if you have any information, you contact Crime Stoppers. That number at the bottom of your screen there, 719-542-STOP. A threat at a Colorado Springs high school forced students and teachers on lockout. That was the second threat reported in just 2 days. Now, this one happened in southeast Colorado Springs at Pikes Peak Elementary on Friday morning. Now, the tip came in through Safe to Tell. District officials say the tip was vague and unclear, but they do take every tip very seriously. They even called Springs Police to help assist.
My son is in there, so if something would have happened, I mean, I wouldn't know what would go on or what would they do.
Now, the second threat that happened at Doherty High School, police say a student sent in this photo to another student on Thursday with the message, quote, don't come to school, and this drawing of a gun. Now, that student was suspended. After a very fun week at the National Western Stock Show, we finally have a winner. But the story of the night was really for the junior auctioned. Grand champion steer Remy was sold for $117,000 last night to Ames Construction at the National Western Stock Show's Junior Livestock Auction. A 16-year-old girl says she was completely in shock to win with her steer. She says the money she earns will go to her college fund. Oh, that's good. And all grand champion steers got to strut down a red carpet in the lobby of the Brown Palace Hotel. Well, all across Colorado, fans are gearing up for tomorrow's big game, but can the stress of cheering for the Broncos lead to health problems? Uh-oh. Well, a Fountain homeowner, Travis Dumas, built his own Broncos man cave. All right. Well, he says he is such a super fan, his blood boils when Denver is trailing in a nail biter. And KRDO News Channel 13's Dr. John Torres, he says if you start to get too excited or too angry, it's okay to take a short time out and take a short breather from the game.
The stress you get from this Bronco fever, from the football fever, it adds adrenaline to your system, especially during the game when everything's hot and heavy. That adrenaline can bump up your blood pressure, can cause you to have an increased risk of heart conditions. So you just got to be careful.
And Dr. Torres says if you're at Sports Authority Field tomorrow, if you're one of the lucky fans, or if you're at a watch party tomorrow, keep an eye on your friends and family, especially if they're older. Take it easy, everybody. We all want the Broncos to win, but got to be safe there. Well, Broncos mania is continuing today in just a little more than 24 hours. Our Denver Broncos, of course, are facing the New England Patriots for the AFC Championship. Fans all across the state are getting pumped up for the game. Check out this huge pep rally took place in Denver yesterday. Of course, it sent an electric shock through fans and got everyone excited to beat the Pats tomorrow afternoon. And speaking of the Pats, they have officially arrived. Tom Brady and his team landed in Denver yesterday evening, but this is how they were greeted. DIA Airport created a very special runway for the team's plane to land on. They added the number 18 as a very special way to welcome to Broncos country. DIA tweeted out these photos early yesterday evening. Love that they did that. Got to welcome them in the right way, right? And speaking of which, we have just gotten so many fantastic photos from viewers getting ready for the game tomorrow. Check out these Broncos fans. This is from Tofola and Rickley Dentistry showing their Broncos pride. Ladies, great job. That's some talent right there. Great formation. Thanks everyone for sending in their photos. We want to see more from you. Let us know, how are you sporting your orange and blue today? Send us your photos to KRDO.com. Tweet them or post them to our Facebook page, KRDO News Channel 13. Time now, 8:42. Well, some potentially devastating news for hundreds of patients at a Massachusetts medical clinic. Officials believe several may have been exposed to a deadly disease after having a colonoscopy. How it happened, that's coming up. And another health alert to warn you about this morning. We'll show you how to spot this salad in your fridge, or a salad in your fridge, after it was recalled. We'll have the details coming up. Welcome back, everyone. Taking a live look. People going for walks already in Manitou Springs, right on Manitou Avenue. With our Neighborhood Weather Network cameras, you can see the sun is out, 41 degrees. It's not even 9 a.m. That is pretty nice to begin our weekend Saturday morning. And our time is now just about 8:46. Nearly 300 colonoscopy patients in Massachusetts may have been exposed to a potentially deadly disease. Now, the patients got the procedure at the Bay State Noble Hospital in Westfield in 2012 and 2013. Officials say there was a possibility to exposed HIV as well as hepatitis B and C. Now, that's because the colonoscopy instruments were not properly disinfected. The hospital says there is relatively little chances that patients were actually infected.
I'm extremely confident that patients were at low risk, but now our job is to be certain that there was no patient harm, and that's the testing phase. Hope to have that wrapped up in days to weeks.
The hospital has notified the patients that need to be screened for those diseases. Complementary medicine is something that a growing number of Americans are swearing by. They seem to be putting their money where their aches and pains are. Everything's right here in this ABC report in this morning's Health Alert.
Acupuncture, chiropractic therapy, and massage. Effective or not, a growing number of Americans are seeking out these therapies. CDC researchers finding that in 2012, more than 8% of Americans reported using a chiropractor. Nearly 7% said they looked to massage therapy, and about 2% trying acupuncture. The popularity of all three up compared to 10 years prior. But perhaps the biggest surprise, most people using any of these alternative therapies are willing to pay out of pocket, since insurance doesn't usually pick up the bill, and when it does, it is usually only partially covered. Are these treatments worth the money, covered or not? There's still not much strong science. The best approach, of course, is to talk with your doctor to see if a complementary therapy is safe for you. If you get a green light, try it and see if it's worth handing over your cash. With this Medical Minute, I'm Carla Barrierena.
And we do want to warn you of one recall that's in effect for various brands of packaged salad that could be linked to a deadly listeria outbreak. The Center for Disease Control and Prevention says a dozen people were hospitalized in six states. One patient died from the listeria infection. Officials say the patients all ate packaged salads that came from a Dole processing plant in Springfield, Ohio. Now, the company has issued out a voluntary recall for its salads showing a certain manufacturing code. The important identified is the letter A at the beginning of that code. If you see that, you should throw your salad away. Time now, 8:48.
Bye. It's a beautiful start to our Saturday morning around Southern Colorado. Tomorrow we'll feature more clouds than what we're seeing right now on our Viura Wireless Network camera in Pueblo to the northeast of town, looking back towards the west and towards the mountains. We will see some of that mountain snow. We'll show you what Skycast thinks in terms of the snow totals coming up in just a couple of minutes. nice start to our Saturday morning around southern Colorado. We're seeing some sun mixed in with a few clouds. Here's the view from our Vera Wireless Network camera in Rocky Ford to the east of town, looking back towards some of the mountains. Of course, the mountains will be areas that will pick up some good amounts of snow over the next day or two. But right now in Rocky Ford, we're not expecting a huge amount, an inch to 3 inches at most, as we go through the next day or day and a half, looking back towards, of course, Highway 50. Just off to the east of the city. As we look at our highs today, speaking of the mountains, locations in the high country are going to top out in the 20s, 30s, and 40s. 23 at Gunnison, 48 at Saleta, 36 your high today in Leadville, 35 in Alamosa. Zooming in on the southeastern plains, Rocky Ford will top out at 62 there, 63 in Ordway, and also at Los Animas, 60 in Eads, 59 in Sheridan Lake, 57 down in Kim along 160. As we go out and about in Pueblo, Fremont, and Custer counties, 47 in Westcliff, 56 at Texas Creek, 64 high today in Penrose, 62 at Pueblo West, and 60 in Colorado City. Up to the Pikes Peak region we go. Temperatures here are going to be topping out in the 50s and 60s, at least in El Paso County. We'll get into the upper 40s and lower 50s in Teller County. 51 at Woodland Park, 50 in Divide, 48 in Cripple Creek, 62 in Fountain, and 60 degrees here in town. Speaking of here in town, the American Furniture Warehouse camera looking back towards UCCS, 44 degrees the temperature right now at I-25 and Fillmore. Skyscan, satellite, and radar, not really too much to look at this morning. We're seeing a few clouds mixed in with lots of sunshine, as we just showed you a minute ago with those cameras. And you notice that as you look at your Skyscan and Skycast, we don't see too much in the way of any kind of clouds or showers until later on this evening. We'll begin to see those clouds thicken up as we go through Saturday night at 6 o'clock, and by early Sunday morning, right at midnight, we'll see some of those clouds again possibly making their way through the region. Watch out for some patchy fog tomorrow. We've already seen it in Lamar this morning. It's a possibility as we go through our Sunday morning as well. By Sunday afternoon, well, we're going to see that snow begin to really make its way through the region. A nice afternoon this afternoon, then of course the snow develops as we go through our Sunday afternoon into our Sunday night. Look what happens right here, this dark spot of blue between the Springs and Denver, just as people are heading home from the Broncos-Patriots game tomorrow afternoon. As we look at our Skycast snow totals, we notice that totals have gone down a little bit from the earlier run this morning, but still decent amounts. Our friend Larry in Divide, Skycast thinks he'll pick up about 4.5 inches. Skycast snow totals also in the wets, a little bit lower than they were this morning. The highest totals are once again going to be up in the high country. And out in the southeastern plains, Kim should pick up about 2, 2.5 inches by 6 o'clock Monday morning. And we'll see a little bit of snow as well as you head points eastward over towards Lamar. Spring 7-day forecast, high temperatures go from 60 today to 37 on Monday. Then we see the temperatures rise back up, lower to middle 50s by Thursday and Friday. Lows are sitting in the teens and 20s. In Pueblo, our 7-day forecast, our high temperatures go from the mid-60s this afternoon to the lower 40s on Monday, with a stop in the mid-50s on Sunday. Temperatures then make their way back into the 50s and 60s later on. In Canyon City, our high temperature goes from 62 to 40 between Saturday and Monday. Then temperatures rise back up into the mid to upper 50s by Thursday and Friday. And in Teller County, we're in the low 50s today. Then it's mid to upper 20s on Monday. Lower 40s as we go through our Thursday and Friday, after a brief stop in the mid 30s on Wednesday. The low temperatures are going to be rising up to from the upper single digits on Wednesday morning into the low 20s by Friday morning. Overall, big roller coaster, big roller coaster.
Yeah, lots of ups and downs there.
That, you know, the little kids can't ride. That's the kind of temperature swings that we're talking about this week.
Gotcha. All right, Jay, thanks so much for the forecast. Appreciate it. All right, now it's time to check out which furry friend at the Humane Society needs a new home. The sweet cat is ready to be adopted this morning. Everyone meets Lola, our pet of the week.
Good morning. I'm Katie McDevitt from Humane Society of the Pikes Peak region, and I'd like to introduce you to my friend Lola. Lola is a 2-year-old spayed short hair with a shiny black coat. She came to HSPPR because her previous owner was allergic. She has lived with a small dog and children and fit right in. Lola had a wound on her back leg, but it's healing nicely and she's ready to find a new family. Just like the song says, whatever Lola wants, Lola gets. And right now, Lola wants you to bring her home forever. Lola's adoption fee is just $75, which includes a voucher for a veterinarian exam, vaccinations, 30 days of pet health insurance, and a microchip. We open for adoptions today at 11 a.m., so come by in person to 610 Abbott Lane or visit us online at hsppr.org and give Lola or one of her furry friends waiting for a new home a happy tale. And don't forget to share your happy tales on Facebook and Twitter, hashtag happy tales, happy hearts.
here today, Mike Everett.
Welcome back, everyone. Woo! If you're not looking up at your TV, do yourself a favor because this is gorgeous. A view of Crested Butte Ski Resort. A live look right now. 19 degrees there. Chilly, but that is really not too bad for not even 9 a.m. Just doesn't even look real. Picture perfect. Great view and conditions for skiers and snowboarders, all the weekend warriors out there. Time now, 8:58. And check this out. A man in Nebraska is getting extra creative to clear a path in the snow. He's using a snow plow wheelchair. He's an Iraq War veteran who says he's on a mission to help his neighbors. The vet even built this entire chair from scratch on his own just so he could help out others and make it easier to get through the snowstorm. That is impressive and looks like it's really doing the job. Very cool. Well, pie lovers rejoice. Today is National Pie Day. The American Pie Council has celebrated National Pie Day since 1986. The first pies appeared around 9500 BC, also known as the First Stone Age. The most popular flavors, fruits such as apples and blueberry pie. The council urges those to go out and try a slice of pie of their favorite pie and help celebrate the unofficial holiday. We even had a fist pump from Jay over here. No one saw that, but he's excited. All right, now let's time to see how you wake up Colorado. We have an awesome picture from Jeff. This is from Ellicott. Just gorgeous sunrises this morning. Jay, we've been getting so many photos this morning. They're all just beautiful.
Stuff, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It looks like it's going to be a very nice day today, too. Temperatures right now sitting in the 40s in the Springs, below zero in the mountains, but you'll rise up, too. Eventually, everyone makes their way into the 60s along and east of I-25. Mike Everett tracks those temperatures for you today.
All right, big changes on the way, though, if you're a Broncos fan headed to the stadium. Thanks for watching, everyone.